What does it mean to be called crazy in a crazy world? Listen to Madness Radio, Voices and Visions from Outside Mental Health. Tuesdays, 4 to 5 p.m. Eastern on Pacifica Affiliates WXOJLPFM, Northampton, Massachusetts, and KWMD in Kasilof and Anchorage, Alaska. Produced by Freedom Center and the Icarus Project. Streaming, podcasting, and archive at madnessradio.net. Thanks for tuning in to Madness Radio. This is your host, Will Hall. And today I'm recording a broadcast from Warsaw, Poland, where I'm traveling and doing a little bit of work, giving some talks and visiting friends after being at the Diversity Conference in London, England last week. I'm here with Bogna Szymkiewicz, who is a psychologist working in Warsaw. She's also an assistant professor at Warsaw University. And I'm going to be speaking with her about trauma, about what she calls wounded states of consciousness and how our past hurt affect relationships in the present. So thank you very much for joining us on Madness Radio, Bogna.
Thank you. I'm very, very happy to be able to talk to you.
Right. Well, it's great to be here because it really underscores that the work that's going on in helping people with trauma is really international, and people are working on this in many, many different countries. And you are a psychologist who has a private practice, and you see individuals and work with groups. And most of the people that you work with have some kind of past abuse or trauma experience. Is that right?
Many people do. And I also need to say that my background is in process-oriented psychology, process work developed by Arnie Mindell and his colleagues. I've been working in Poland, in Warsaw, and it is where I'm based. And I also worked in US and Germany and Russia. And internationally, you see how similar we are in our deep wounds. So I think, yeah, and I work a lot with people who have been traumatized, and sometimes, you know, some of these traumas are so devastating and big, and sort of objectively everybody would say it is a huge thing, but some of our traumas are not that obvious. And still that they affect our lives. And I think this is important also to know.
So you're talking about people who maybe are survivors of child abuse or sexual assault, but also people who are maybe survivors of war or natural disaster.
Right. Yeah, that's true.
So maybe we can start out with just maybe a definition of what you would consider trauma to be from the framework that you work with.
So trauma, I would say that we can talk about trauma each time when a person encounters some kind of a force that is too big to react to it. So that our body and our mind, our whole person, is not able to find an adequate response to it. So, you know, if there we have two little boys who hit each other, even if they're in troubles afterwards, I wouldn't call it trauma necessarily. But if a person, a little boy, will be hit by someone who is huge, and is not able to defend himself and find a reaction, then we can say that it is the traumatic experience. Something happens then that the person freezes. And I think each of us can find this kind of experiences in daily life as well. Someone says something, right? Especially if it is a person who has higher power in whatever area. And we are just like blank. So to a degree, this is what happens in each traumatic experience.
So does that explain then why maybe two people can have a very similar experience, maybe survive a natural disaster or have a parent who is physically violent with them, and they will react very differently? One person will just sort of go on with their lives, and the other person will be very deeply affected by it?
This is very hard to say what is the difference. And I think that that some of us are equipped very early with different mechanisms to meet difficulties, right? And I have always like a hard time saying like why one person is doing, in the similar conditions is doing better than the other. I don't know. We are so different. And the circumstances, even if they seem to be the same, they're very different. They're different for a person with different background.
What are some of the signs that someone has trauma or has experiencing the effects of trauma?
In the moment, what happens at the moment of trauma is just this emptiness. We are just, as I said, we go blank very often, and a person is not able to even feel what she or he feels, and then there are different feelings coming up. But if you're looking at the past abuse or past trauma, there are certain signs. And again, I think each of us can find it in ourselves in certain moments, but the degree is different. So one of the signs would be this tendency to get into a kind of a trance, just not quite being here. The way we experience our emotions. And a person who with past abuse history have this tendency to have very strong emotions or to be extremely cut off from the emotions. So they kind of in certain situations would get possessed by anger, fear, rage, despair, or they have this tendency to be completely cold and detached, as if they were robots. So this extreme ways of feelings, experiencing emotions would be the next thing.
So that extreme, could it also apply to someone maybe who's kind of detached in the sense of being sort of happy and sort of like peaceful, like kind of like an almost spiritual state, but actually there's trauma underneath that? Is that one of the things that you see as well?
I think it happens also that there are people who are, the first thing I was thinking more about, people who are very rational and they're having everything under control, you know, like the rational control and often also controlling other afterwards. But I think it can also go into the spiritual peacefulness. But then we heard the stories about people who are very spiritually developed, and then all of a sudden they would just do things that nobody would think about or had this breakdowns. But who was it? Jack Kornfield, I think, one of the psychologists, the transpersonal psychologists, who said that some people who are going only through their on who are too fast, if one can say so, on the spiritual path without meeting their own emotions and personal history, are doing sort of a spiritual bypass, like, you know, the shortcut. But then all these histories they don't disappear.
So going back to what you said about the trance, is that what we also call dissociation? Like someone who leaves their body and is numbed out and kind of in a spacey place?
Yes. And I think that there are just, again, different degrees of trances. There are sometimes, there are people who, especially in social situations, would just have this momentary being, like, yeah, spaced out for a moment. And then yes, dissociation is part of it. It's like another form of a trance.
So you mentioned dissociation or trance, and then you said emotional extremes. Someone would be very cut off. Maybe they're very rational and cold, but then they have this explosive side, or maybe they're in this spiritual bypass state. What are some of the other signs that someone might be struggling with trauma?
The way we approach other people, often there is mistrust. And it is understandable because very often, especially if trauma is connected with the human abuse, right? Not natural disaster, but human abuse, being abused by another human being. The mistrust is very deeply rooted. So a person may even think consciously that it is that people are okay, but this mistrust, this knowledge that another human being is capable of hurting me so deeply that I cannot defend myself, is somewhere at the bottom of the way we approach other people. And it is especially clear in close relationships. So again, another sign of past traumas would be many difficulties that are happening in close intimate relationships. Another sign, and it is very important, I think, also to know, is that many physical symptoms are just directly connected to traumatic experiences. So I know it from my experience with my clients. Sometimes when I work with my clients and we focus on the experience of their symptom, not just the medical definition, but the experience of pain, they would all of a sudden remember the scene of abuse as if it was sort of encoded in the symptom.
What kind of symptoms are you talking about, like headaches or like fatigue and that kind of thing?
Headaches, also very often different symptoms in the genital area. And these are not necessarily connected with sexual abuse, but also sometimes with just physical abuse in childhood. Also some problems with the spine, throat, voice, anything around that might be also connected with the abuse.
So you mentioned the idea that there's this mistrust that gets created. Now, it seems to me that would be really worsened if it's child abuse or abuse by someone who you are betrayed by because you're very close to them and they're protecting you or they're in the role of helping or protecting you. Does that make the trauma more deep and more difficult to struggle with? And is it something that sometimes people just get into, their entire personality is shaped by the trauma? It starts at a very early age and that's kind of all they know for their whole lives?
Actually, yes. I think that traumas are just these points that make our personality in some way. But I'm just thinking how to talk about it so that we are also somehow positive about it. For one reason or another, we humans are going through traumas. I think it would be better if we had the society and, you know, the conditions in which we wouldn't. Actually, one of my teachers, shaman's teacher, said that humans are too delicate and fragile to experience violence. And then when we experience violence, we are creating sort of this ego personalities that are like armors or something like that. And from the other side, if you will look at this, yes, these traumas are, I have this idea that if you look at life, you like sort of go through life, and then there is this moment of trauma and everything freezes so that you can't just make the next step. Something is like cycling around that point. So that as if we were just stuck in this place. And I think that's why, on one hand, it is making our personality. On the other, it is something that we need to, it's great if we can work on so that we can be more free.
I was really intrigued by this idea of wounded states of consciousness, which is really a way of seeing a traumatized state as being something that's really happening right now in the present and then mapping out what it's all about. Tell us about that and then how that can be useful for understanding what people are going through.
Well, when I was working with people, I realized that on one hand, we are talking about, you know, past abuse and traumas, but then I noticed that many of us got into this kind of strange states of consciousness in everyday life. And it happens mostly when we get hurt, especially if we get hurt by people who are either very close to us or important to us in some other way. And then I started to study it and I wanted to understand what happens, right? Okay, someone is saying something that I don't like, or and why all of a sudden I feel like as if I was under, you know, behind the glass window and I can't think about anything else. What is happening there? And one interesting thing that I found was that research actually shows that social rejection, hurt is connected with rejection. We feel that some part of us, or I as a person, that I'm rejected by someone who is important to me. Now, it occurs that human beings, we react to rejection in the same way as we react to physical pain. You know about it? That's so interesting that if we are rejected the same, some research shows that the same areas of the brain are activated as in the physical pain.
So when we say emotional hurt and physical hurt, there's actually a part of the brain that's actually is identical for both of them. Hurt is hurt.
Yes, and that's why I think that if we say that someone has a broken heart, it is a metaphor, but the feeling is really physical. It's very real. Now, what happens then is one is that we are in pain, but then that our consciousness doesn't work at the exactly same way as normally. What is the repeated experience of people who get hurt? First of all, first moment is a shock. Usually, we just don't believe, we can't believe that it happened, and it links it to trauma. It's like as if we couldn't, it something doesn't fit to what we know about life and other people and the world, and we don't know what to do with it. It's just too much. And then the world shrinks. We feel that we cannot. The interesting thing, sorry, just remember that the interesting thing was when I asked my clients to draw a picture of their states of consciousness. Usually, there was some enclosed space and something chaotic inside. And then inside this space, the things that just a moment ago were important are not that important anymore. And we have this feeling that our thoughts are coming back again and again like a broken record. And our feelings are very intense. And it is that, like, we don't have any control over it. So there is this small world of same feelings and pain, and usually we also feel they're very lonely. So this is the experience that many of us have, as I say, just to a degree in like everyday life.
But then certain events happen that trigger us going into this wounded state of consciousness.
Yes, because what I'm saying is that this happens just in during the situations when someone is telling a betrayal or criticism or, you know, difficult relationship situations. But then what happens is that it links somewhere in our memory. We go into this past stories, so. The I that I am today does not have the control over my way of understanding life and perceiving even the world. Someone else inside of me takes over. Often it is like a hurt child. So even if I am the CEO of a huge company, at the moment when someone really will touch this point, I may feel like a little boy who is helpless and I don't even know that I feel like a little boy. The only thing that I know is that my world is so small and I don't know how to react. So that's the link.
So what, when someone is in this wounded state of consciousness, how would they end up behaving in a relationship, or what would they end up doing?
That's very interesting, because usually at that point, we don't see the other person as a person anymore, as this person. We see this other person as a perpetrator, just generalized perpetrator. And again, it is not that conscious, but we react to the person as if he or she was just there to get us. And there is a split inside. With many people in this wounded states of consciousness, there is a split. On one hand, we feel very much in pain, but the anger and the power that we have sort of operates independently. So that's why we often would shout or scream at another person. All the time feeling that we are a victim. So then we often would have the situation where both persons would feel like victims and behave like oppressors, and they wouldn't even know that they are doing what they are doing.
So you have this, that's really interesting. So you have this split where you're explosive, or you're lashing out, or you're doing something very powerful, but you're completely cut off from it, and your experience on the inside is of being totally powerless, a victim, and totally out of control, whereas actually in reality, you may be completely dominating the whole situation and dominating the room and expressing a huge amount of power.
Yes. And that's why it is so difficult, because there is no one present usually to see what is going on. And one of the reasons why this power is so cut off is that often it is the kind of power that we were a victim of earlier on. So we don't, in a way, we don't want to have this power. We don't want to have this kind of power, because it is associated with bad people in our lives.
So we reach an explosion point. We scream or we lash out. We act just like the abuser that we experienced, but we're totally not identified with it, because that's not us. We don't want to believe that we're actually like that.
Yes, exactly. And we are surprised that the other person does not react to our hurt. And this delicate feelings that we have inside, because we do have this delicate feelings and that we identify with that, but that this whole thing is escalating. And I think it is just so, I can relate to that. I've done that. Like, I can talk about my clients, but I also have... And even with some consciousness, it's so hard to change the place, you know, the identity, just to feel, okay, I am powerful. When I'm screaming and, you know, when I'm lashing out, as you said, I have some power. I just don't feel it, because it's not in my hands.
So everybody goes through this at some point. I mean, especially I'm thinking in terms of relationships, when you get right into it with the other person. But someone who's really traumatized or really been very hurt might be very dominated by these kinds of experiences and have them frequently and very extreme. Is that so? It's kind of a continuum, is that right?
Yes. I think everybody does that, and because all of us were traumatized in some way, but some people do more than the others. And also some forms of this, of the way we use our power, are not that obvious. Some people scream and shout. Other people would just get cold, right, and not talk, but in a way that is almost as aggressive as shouting. And then they also would not identify with having a lot of power, right? So, but you're right, is people who have been traumatized a lot, the split is also stronger. Usually the wall between, you know, the delicate part and the strong part.
So then you have a situation where two people are expressing a very powerful side, but they're really identified with a really vulnerable side, but they can't see the vulnerability in the other, and then they just keep kind of missing each other, and then it just escalates and escalates and escalates.
Yes, exactly. That's how it looks. And there is also important that there is no one in the whole field to see what is going on. That's why sometimes a mediator or a therapist is important, not necessarily even to do something very special, but just because there is this outside observer.
And also it seems like that's why some of the most painful kinds of abuse and trauma and violence happen kind of behind closed doors or in very intimate, isolated, solitary sorts of situations.
It is also because in these situations we open up to this vulnerable and delicate side. And then it hurts more. And I think the next step I would say for most of us is just to see how we can help the sites meet. How can we identify with the power that we do have, and that possesses us from time to time? So that's the important part of therapeutic work.
And this is, I think, maybe the unique contribution that I think process-oriented psychology makes and your work makes, is the idea of somehow claiming and identifying with that powerful side that appears in this sort of unconscious or out of control way. So talk to us about how it is that you work with clients and how you actually get someone who's in a wounded state of consciousness to a point where they start to move towards healing and changing the patterns that they are stuck in.
Well, if I work with someone who is in this wounded state and remembers or is going into past abuse issue, the first thing is that I try to make sure that the person is in control of the whole situations, because as I said at the beginning, what is the most difficult part of trauma is that we are unable to respond to the situation. So then in a therapeutic situation, I try to make sure that the person is not dominated by me at that point.
Can you give us an example of what that would look like in terms of a client in a session with you?
Let's say that we have that I'm talking with a client, and a client is talking about the quarrel she had with her husband, and then she said, "Oh, it reminds me of my father." And then it's a pause. So then I say, "Okay, would you like to talk about it?" And she goes like, "As a pause?" And then she said, "Oh, yes, sure." Okay, so now what I'm paying attention to is that there are two signals. One is this pause, and then there is a reaction like of a good pupil, right? And nice girl who is saying, okay, you know, the therapist or the teacher is asking me a question, so I am going to nicely respond to the teacher. Now, I would say to her, I notice these two sides. Let's explore both of them. There is one part of you that would like to talk about it, and there is another part that hesitates. And it is a very, very important. It's also you. And I think this is the way, the attitude when we are working with trauma, is just to really pay attention to this little signals, because there is this, you know, the missing parts of a person who were like sort of lost in the trauma situation usually can be found there.
So this is, so you would help the person to gain control of the situation by noticing that a part of them is hesitating and maybe doesn't want to agree with you and just go on and talk about it further.
Yeah. And then let's say this person would say, you know what, because I would like to. And at the same time, I'm a little afraid. And I'm afraid because you seem to be such a strong person, and I'm not sure if you'll be able to understand me. So then we can really explore it. But the person feels respected with with the these parts or little experiences that she has marginalized herself for a long time. So this is the one thing. The other thing is to help a person to tell the story. I mean, the trauma, traumatic stories are, again, the loneliness is so devastating when we think about it. That we usually at this situations, we had this feeling that the whole world is against us, or that there is no one to help, and sharing this story is often like a healing situation in itself, but provided that it is that the listener is really listening, and that's so important. I would say if you would like to help a friend or anyone who had a trauma, just remember at least at the time of listening to be on the side of a so-called victim, not to be rational, not to understand the abuser. Because this is what we keep doing. And the person who couldn't defend herself or himself needs understand to be understood.
They really need an ally and someone to be on their side, because when it was happening, there was no one there. There was no one on their side.
Exactly. So, and I remember once, you know, after the workshop, that's why I'm talking about it and emphasizing it that much. We had a workshop about trauma and working with trauma, and half a year later, a woman came to my office, and she said that during this workshop, she was kind of doing the exercise. She was a psychologist herself, and she was talking about her alcoholic father and her role as the eldest of the children, and someone who was just doing an exercise with her in the parish said, "Oh, but you know, you gain something out of being that big sister." And she said that it took her half a year to be even able to talk about it again, that she completely shut her down. So I think that's also something to remember, that at these places, we are so vulnerable, so delicate. So when we are listening to someone, let's try to be just a feeling person and not smart. It doesn't help to be smart when we are listening to trauma.
So what are some of the other key parts to helping someone to change and grow? You mentioned helping the person to have a sense of control, and then you mentioned listening to their story, but in a way that really is allied and supportive of being on their side.
Making space for the feelings, but not pushing the feelings. So just being open to the feelings, it's part of listening to the story. And then there is another part that that I have learned during my process work training, and I find it really very helpful. And it is trying to find a missing reaction, to find a power that was needed at the time of trauma. And we can do it in many different ways, provided that the person is ready. Again, I mean, the two points are always there. But if a person is ready, we may enact the situation so that the person could or have puppets or, you know, someone who would just slowly show the situation. And then we can ask the person to see what was missing. And what I find very helpful is not to be very rational at that point. And my clients often find it important to when I say, you know what, if everything was possible, and if you could use any force that is available in the universe, what would you do? Or who could come and change it? And something in us knows what was missing.
What are some examples of kinds of things that people would come up with?
They really vary. I just remember a few examples. Let's say that sometimes if we have the clear example of physical violence, let's say, one of my clients would say, you know what, I can see the Godzilla coming. I said, great. So what is it about Godzilla? And then I was thinking, you know, Godzilla is huge and she can probably, whatever, smash the abuser. And she said, you know what? Godzilla is so furry and so soft that it could just take me and hold me in its arms. And then that was the missing part. This woman was very strict and very hard on herself. What she actually was missing at that point was just holding herself in her arms. Then another person at the same similar situation would say, you know, I just would like to someone who is really strong and would just hit the abuser just with the full force. And then we try to transform this force, because it is not about jumping from one side to another, right, and just becoming now the one who is fighting other people physically, but using this power. And this is often very difficult for people because they don't want to. This is what we were talking about. They don't want to identify with this power.
So even though they've had this power in their own lives, when they get out of control and they shut down or they lash out or they're explosive or they're withdrawn, that power is there and it shows up, but they don't identify with it. It's not something that they want to say, yes, this is me. And so you try and get them to engage it and own it.
Exactly. And we start with just playing it a little bit. And with process work, we are... We also say, you know what, you don't have to identify with it for life. Just let's do it for 2 minutes. And it helps, because then it is not that serious immediately and we can really explore it and we don't know what it is. I remember one girl who was working with me, a woman, and she said that she imagined the force that would help her in her, it was just awful situation. Her mother was a teacher and she was just humiliating her in front of the whole class and hitting and all. I mean, really bad story. And then she was just imagining that the force that she needed, that the force that was there was like an elephant. But she said, well, my mother was like an elephant because she would just completely crush me. But then we were experimenting with this elephant force, and she imagined being an elephant. And then she said, you know what? An elephant actually wouldn't be aggressive. The elephant would just roar. Then it occurred she had awful problems with her throat. She couldn't speak loud. And that was the beginning of the work. And then it occurred that she can just have own her own voice and her power that was blocked in her throat. I'm just telling the stories because you can see how many things are linked at these places of trauma.
Did she then go on to like yell and explore getting really loud and using her voice really strongly?
It wasn't just immediate. I would love sometimes if it just goes like that, you know, in 3 minutes. Actually, it took us another few sessions to get into really explore her voice. But yes, and then with the voice came the posture and the certain kind of confidence. It was not just this screaming that we sometimes scream out of helplessness. She was like learning about also her own message, not only, you know, the volume of her voice, but the message that she had, and it was beautiful.
Are there other parts to the healing approach that you take that we haven't gotten into? You mentioned finding the missing piece and then also claiming the force, starting to identify it even if just a little bit.
I think that what I would say it's also important is just that the force is not necessarily what we associate with the word force. that it is sometimes this missing part is the missing energy, as I was saying at this first example with Godzilla, right? That sometimes it is just the attitude, the different kind of attitude that was missing. But I think these are the most important parts, and also the possibility of sharing it and using the power, yeah.
Are there any dangers to, you mentioned when someone is telling their story that it's a very delicate, intimate moment and you want to be very, you know, feeling in your feelings and really committed to being on the person's side. But are there other dangers that are involved with telling stories? Is there a danger that someone could just re-experience the trauma or be re-traumatized or just stir up so much that they'd be overwhelmed again?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So that's, for example, if someone has the difficult stories and they are hesitating if they want to talk about it or not, I'm also checking if it is the right moment in life. Because sometimes if we go into the story and we remember it, it takes sometimes days or weeks to put the pieces back together to some order. So sometimes it is dangerous, but I think not as dangerous as keeping it under the carpet our whole life.
What are examples of times when it might not be the best time to work on it in your life?
Well, you know, if you have an important exam on the next day, or if you're in a difficult situation, for example, I remember this woman who was just having the getting divorced. And it was a difficult situation in court and all that stuff. And she had too much in her everyday life she needed to cope with the mechanisms that were available for her at that point, and just to find some better times later on. Also, another danger, when you're talking about dangers, another danger is if we don't take to account pain and delicate feelings, and we just jump from feeling like a victim to the, you know, feeling powerful. I think that's also a big danger generally in our culture, that we just are, and it is understandable on one hand, because it is much nicer to feel powerful than helpless, right? But if we don't go through this helplessness and pain as real part of human experience, if it is not integrated into our power, there is a danger of becoming blind to the vulnerability of other people.
Maybe becoming oppressors ourselves, I guess.
Yes, yes.
You mentioned before the one other possibility is getting really identified with being in this victim kind of role. Can you tell us about that? Because it seems like that it's kind of a difficult and delicate thing to talk about, that because you don't want to kind of blame the person themselves because something terrible happened to them. But on the other hand, you know, staying in the victim role is not helpful either.
Yeah, that's a very delicate thing. And The thing is that if we deal with a person who is in such a state, I think that even if it is ourselves, it is important to embrace both. Right? If you are telling someone, oh, you know, you behave like a victim, it won't help. Even if the person for a moment would just pull herself together, it is not. The victim needs to be understood, that whatever in her state, and yet asked to give some space for other parts too. And if we can embrace both or different parts, this is important. I work with people because this is so tricky. Many people, on one hand, they identify with the pain, the victim side. And at the same time, consciously, they reject it. So that would be clients who come and say, oh, you know what, I'm crying again. I hate myself when I'm crying. But I'm crying, right? So there is just this I do it sometimes too. I mean, a bit less now, but I used to do it. And I remember one of the most healing experiences in my life was when one of my therapists said, you know what? So let's make a deal. You will cry now for 3 minutes, but with 100% acceptance. And it was so amazing because then it just somehow, I don't know how to say it, just melts. So that if we accept a certain experience, it's much easier to change it. The problem with our experience and this being in a victim position is not that we are too weak or not inadequate or something. The problem is that we are stuck in it. And we are part of the reason why we are stuck is that we don't accept it. So it is a paradox. Once we accept it, it's easier to go on. And then probably we will visit this state of being a victim in our lives again. But knowing already that we don't have to stay there.
What about a situation where someone is telling you a story of an abuse experience that they had and you really are wanting to be on their side and believe in them, but you're also not sure of the truth of what they're saying? Or maybe they're only giving you, maybe it's a couple, and they're only giving you their side of the story, and then, you know, next time you're going to hear the other side of the story, and it's going to look very different. How do you balance that need to kind of be objective with the need that you have to really be someone's ally?
Well, the good thing is that I am a psychotherapist and not a judge, so it helps, and I don't have to know the objective truth. What I am mostly interested in is the emotional truth. So sometimes even if a person is telling me a story or a person is not sure, you know, they have saying, oh, you know what, it seems something happened in this room when I was 8 years old, but it is not possible. I don't think that something happened. Then I even sometimes ask a person to fantasize and say, okay, forget it. If it was true or not, does not matter at that point. We will come back to it. But in some world, in the world of your experience, something happened. What was it? What could have happened? And then the person, through even inventing a story, is getting into some kind of an emotional truth. And later on, we can check it and we can just think about what is the difference between this and that. I can give you an example. Let's say that a person feels that her father hit her on her nose, but she's almost sure that it never happened. And then what occurred actually was the real story was that the father was, he was actually a Vietnam veteran, and he had a lot of like unprocessed violence inside, but he was controlling himself. But often when he was angry at a child, he would have just these fists and to clench the teeth like that. So the child reacted to the signals. And yes, it is a difference that he never really did it, but in some fantasy world, he did it. So in this fantasy world, the child needed to be able to react to it. So this is what I'm doing. I'm just working on the fantasy world, looking for the emotions that were involved so that they are not frozen there, looking for the missing reactions. And then, yes, we are trying to check with the objective world because it makes a difference as well.
Bogna, we don't have a lot of time left, but I'm really interested in asking you about what do you think is the spiritual side to trauma and abuse? Is there a spiritual side? Is there some deeper meaning or purpose why people go through these experiences? And do they actually come out of them with some kind of benefit or gift or something positive?
That's such a great question. And I've been struggling with it for a long time. And I would say that the answer depends on who is asking and who is giving the question, who is asking and who is giving an answer. If the world, the outside world, is telling a traumatized person that there is a spiritual meaning to the trauma that the person went through, I would say it is abusive. Now, if a person who has gone through the trauma discovers something behind it and develops on a spiritual level, and it happens very often, then yes, there is a spiritual meaning into it. So that's how I understand it. That's a huge difference, because if we are trying to tell someone who has gone through trauma that there is, you know, it was good for you, in a way, it was good for you, it was not. And yet, if this person is finding through it the power, great, that's fantastic. And often people are going to the realms that they would never gone to if they didn't have through these difficulties.
Bogna, we are just about out of time. Can you let people know how to get in touch with you? Do you have an email address, or is there a website or some way of getting in touch with you?
Yes, I have a website, and it's simple. It is just like my name. It is bogna.info, bogna.info. And my email address is bs@bogna.info.
Bogna Szymkiewicz, thank you so much for joining us today on Madness Radio. It's been a great honor having you here and to be here in Warsaw, Poland, visiting, and to have this opportunity to interview you.
Thank you.
You've been listening to an interview with Bogna Szymkiewicz, and she is a psychologist in Warsaw, Poland, working as assistant professor at Warsaw University. She's also in private practice and works with groups, and she is a teacher at the Process Work School in Poland. That's about all the time we have this week on Madness Radio. Thanks a lot for tuning in. You've been listening to Madness Radio, voices and visions from outside mental health. Madness Radio broadcasts every Tuesday, 4 to 5 p.m. Eastern on Pacifica affiliates WXOJLPFM, Northampton, Massachusetts, and KWMD, Kasilof, and Anchorage, Alaska. Produced by peer-run mental health communities freedom-center.org and theicarusproject.net. Listen to our internet stream, podcasts, and show archives at madnessradio.net. If you have an idea for a story or guest on Madness Radio to help us get broadcast on a station near you, or if you just want to share what's in your head, contact radio@madnessradio.net.